We're going to hear the very talented Ella Markovsky. Ella, please.
Okay, hello everybody.
Ella is another student of us in the Nano Center that received the fellowship, and she's a Nano Fellow. So.
Yes. Hello.
Hello everybody. I would like to thank the organizers and the Nano Center for the opportunity to present my work. I am from the laboratory of Ronitsa Cifainaro, and I'm going to talk today about targeting cancer, and specifically cancer stem cells, with polymer therapeutics. So first, a little introduction on cancer. The tumor grows as a small mass of cells, and in order for it to grow and expand beyond the size of a few millimeters, it needs to recruit blood cells to get nutrients and oxygen. So when a tumor reaches a certain size, it has blood vessels in the tumor. However, these blood vessels are not normal. They're enlarged and very leaky, and also there's a lack of normal lymphatic drainage from the tumor. So here you can see imaging of the blood vessels in the mouse that was done in our lab with a small microscopic probe that goes inside the mouse when it's alive and under anesthesia. So this here you can see the normal blood vessels, which are this is a fluorescent imaging with a macromolecule that is fluorescently labeled, and you can see the structures of the blood vessels that are very nice and neat, and the fluorescent material stays inside the blood vessels and all the surrounding tissue is dark. However, this is in the same mouse, but in the blood vessels inside the tumor. And you can see this huge difference, that the blood vessel in the tumor is very large, and the blood flow is not straight. It goes back and forth, and you can see leaking of the fluorescent material to the background. Now, when we talk about drug targeting to the tumor, when we use regular drugs, we inject them IV, and they can go all over the body. They can simply diffuse out of blood vessels and go everywhere, and therefore we get less than optimal efficiency of the drugs, because only a portion of what we give reaches the tumor. And also we get the side effects all over the body because of the action of the drugs on healthy tissues. Now, if we bind these drugs to a macromolecular carrier, similarly to the fluorescent material here, they can't exit normal blood vessels. They can only exit in the leaky blood vessels of the tumor. So we get accumulation of the drugs inside the tumor, and we don't get drugs in the normal tissues. So there are several types of these macromolecular nanocarriers. We are working with the polymer therapeutics, and more specifically with the polymer drug conjugates. Now, this is the general structure of a drug polymer conjugate. We have this polymer backbone that we can choose according to our needs. Of course, it needs to be water soluble, and we can choose the composition of the polymer. The drugs are attached to the polymer through linkers. We can attach one drug or a combination of drugs. We can also attach targeting moieties and the fluorescent probes. And we can choose the linkers that we use to bind the drugs to the polymer. They can be, we can choose them to be cleaved specifically at the site of the tumor using specific characteristics of the tumor environment, like low pH, or enzymes that are overexpressed in the tumor, so we can have pH-sensitive linkers, or we can have linkers that are cleaved specifically by those enzymes. And so we get additional specificity of the drug release in the tumor, but not in the healthy tissues. So there are a lot of advantages to using drug polymer nanoconjugates. As I said, we get altered distribution of the drug in the body. We get accumulation only in the sites of the tumor where the vessels are enlarged and leaky, and therefore we get reduced toxicity. We can use several drugs on the same polymer, and this is an ideal platform for combination therapy because we can make sure that two drugs that have a synergistic activity will reach the same cell at the same time and can be in the ratio that we want them and be released in this cell together. We get increased solubility of drugs that have a problem with water solubility. For example, the very potent chemotherapy drug paclitaxel is very hydrophobic, and so when we give it to patients, we need to solubilize it in a special solution that has a lot of side effects of its own, as if the side effects of the paclitaxel alone are not enough. But when we bind the paclitaxel to a water-soluble polymer, we get very good solubility. We can also protect drugs that are sensitive by to the environment of the body by binding them to a polymer, such as sRNA, which is very rapidly degraded in the bloodstream. When we tie it to a polymer or another carrier, it's stable in the bloodstream. We can overcome resistance of the tumor cells to the chemotherapy because we change the path of the internalization of the drugs into the cell, and so sometimes in a cancer cell has a different mechanism to pump out the drugs outside. So when we connect the drugs to the polymer, we change these pumps cannot take out the drug outside of the cell, so we can overcome resistance. And lastly, we can use active targeting, meaning we can attach a targeting moiety to the polymer. This targeting moiety will attach to a molecule that is specifically expressed on the tumor cells, and so we get additional selectivity to targeting the drugs to the tumor, and we also get higher efficacy because, once again, when we use the targeted polymer, we change the path of the internalization of the drug into the cell. And it's internalized by a more efficient and fast mechanism. Okay, so for the active targeting, we chose to use neural cell adhesion molecule, or NCAM. This is the same NCAM that Ron Berylson talked about before, but we use it for a different purpose. So a little about NCAM. It's a cell-cell surface adhesion molecule that has a crucial role during development. But in adults, the NCAM expression is very limited. It's mainly expressed on the neurons and the glia cells of the nervous system, or NK cells, which are a type of cells in the immune system. And it was also found that NCAM is overexpressed in several tumors. And in some of these tumors, NCAM expression predicts a more aggressive behavior and more metastasis and poor prognosis. So this is a good target in itself. And in addition, it was found that the tumor-derived endothelial cells, cells that form the blood vessels in the tumor, that these cells express NCAM, while the cells that build the normal blood vessels don't express NCAM. So we have an additional reason to target it. And lastly, NCAM was shown to be a marker for cancer stem cells in Wilms tumor, which is a renal malignancy in children, kidney cancer. And so I'll explain a little more about what are cancer stem cells. Cancer stem cells are basically a small subtype of cells in the tumor. They have regular stem cells properties of self-renewal and differentiation, which means they basically create all the different cells of the tumor. All the different heterogenic cells arise from these cancer stem cells. And they're also known to have increased resistance to chemotherapy, which means when we treat the cancer with the drugs, even the polymer therapeutics, they're going to kill most of the tumor cells, but the more resistant cancer stem cells can remain. And they can recreate all the rest of the tumor, and the tumor actually returns, and we get the recurrence of the disease. Now, if we use polymer therapeutics that are specifically targeted to cancer stem cells, such as NCAM-targeted polymer carriers, they will specifically attach to those cells and kill them and also kill all the rest of the tumor, and this time the tumor can't return because all the tumor cancer stem cells are gone. So now to the more chemical part. This is the carrier that we are working on. It's based on a polymer that's called polyglutamic acid. It's a polymer of glutamic acid, which is an amino acid that's present in all of our bodies. And to this polymer, we attach an ENCAM-targeting moiety and doxorubicin and paclitaxel, two potent chemotherapy drugs that we found in our lab to have a synergistic activity on several cancer cell lines, such as ovarian carcinoma cells that are also ENCAM-expressing cells and several other cell lines. And I'm going to talk about these ovarian carcinoma cells. Sorry. So a little about the polyglutamic acid. It's a water-soluble polymer. It is multivalent, meaning it has a lot of groups that are available for conjugation of drugs. It's biodegradable. It degrades basically to the glutamic acid, which is an amino acid. And it's non-toxic, as we found in both in the mice and on the cells. The process of we do the polymerization of this polymer in our lab. We prepare it ourselves. The synthesis starts from a glutamic acid protected by O-benzyl. And we create this NCA and carboxyanhydride intermediate, which is a very reactive intermediate. We initiate the polymerization by a primary amine, which causes an opening of the ring, creating another amine in the end, and that can in turn attack another NCA moiety, and therefore this is how the polymerization continues. And we leave it for about a week, and the end product is this polyglutamic acid that has... this is the monomer, which has a carboxylic group to which we can bind our linkers or drugs or targeting moieties. And it also has one terminal amine in the end of each polymer. So the molecular weight that we get is about 10 kilodaltons with a polydispersity of 1.2, which is okay. The actual size is hard to measure because the DLS instrument that's used to measure nanoparticles is not very accurate in the case of polymers because they're not uniform spherical particles, but more like a constantly moving spaghetti. But we can say that the size is roughly about 10 nanometers. And the zeta potential, which is the surface charge, is minus 40, which is good because that means we don't get a lot of aggregation of the polymer in solution. And we also get the good batch-to-batch reproducibility. So the next step was to conjugate the targeting moiety to this polyglutamic acid and to see if it actually binds to our ENCAM-expressing cells. So we labeled this polymer with the FITC, it's a fluorescent moiety, and we examined the binding of this fluorescent protein to the cells. And on this graph, on the x-axis with T, it's fluorescence, and on the y, it's a number of cells. So it means that when cells have fluorescence on their surface, the graph moves to the right. So you can see the unlabeled PGA is in black, and the PGA with the targeting moiety has a shift to the right, which means the cells are labeled more with the fluorescent... which means that the polymer with the targeting moiety binds more to the cells than the regular PGA without the targeting moiety, which is good. So next, we conjugated to this polymer with the targeting moiety, a paclitaxel, a chemotherapy drug, and we wanted to examine if this targeted polymer is more active than the non-targeted one. We incubated the ES2 ovarian carcinoma cells with this treatment. It was a very short incubation, and after that we washed the cells, in order to see effect of the binding, because when we incubate the cells with the treatments for 3 days, everything will come inside, and we won't any, see any difference between between the targeted and the non-targeted. But when we do a short incubation and then wash, that means that what was bound to the cells will enter, and what was not bound will be washed out. So in this, and after that, we leave the cells for 72 hours, and then we count the cells that are still alive after that. And on this graph, we see on the x-axis, it's a concentration of the drug, and this is the cell number. And it basically tells us which concentration of the drug we need to kill the cells. So here, this is the only the PGA and the PGA with the target moiety. We can see that 100% of the cells stay alive in any concentration that we give, which means it's not toxic to the cells. And here we can see the PGA with the paclitaxel, and in red the PGA with the with paclitaxel and the targeting moiety. And we can see that in the same concentration, the targeted PGA kills more cells than the non-targeted one. And here we can see the free drug that is much more active than the conjugates, and it is expected in this setting since the drug penetrates the cells freely, and it has a very rapid action compared to the conjugated, to the polymer conjugated drug, which takes a long time in the cells to enter the cell and then to release the drug, and only then the drug can be active. But for the future, when we will, when we want to see really the effect of the polymer bound drug compared to the free drug, we need to use it in vivo, meaning in a live organism, and only then we'll see the selective distribution and the tumor accumulation, and then we can see the advantage of the polymer carrier. And lastly, we wanted to see the ability of the conjugate to inhibit tube formation of endothelial cells that express NCOM. And when we seed the cells, these are endothelial cells that we isolate in our lab. When we seed them on Matrigel, which is a type of gel, the cells create this vascular network. They actually create capillaries on a plate. This circle here is like a walls of the capillary. But when we see the same cells on Matrigel and we give them our conjugate, we treat them with the conjugate, they try to move and to form the same structures, but they don't succeed. Which means that also in the live organism, the cells won't be able to form the blood vessels that the tumor needs in order to survive. So to summarize, polymers can be used to deliver drugs selectively to tumors, and we can use them to carry a combination of drugs and also a targeting moiety or fluorescent probes. The neural cell adhesion molecule is a marker for cancer stem cells, and we can exploit it to target these cells. A conjugate of PGA with paclitaxel, a chemotherapeutic drug, and NCOM targeting moiety was developed. And this conjugate exhibits cytotoxic and anti-angiogenic activity in vitro. And also wanted to say that the main advantage of the polymer conjugates will be seen only in vivo in a live organism. So I want to thank Professor Nitsachi Fainaro and all the lab members, and thank you to the Nano Center for the generous funding, and thank you for listening.
Thank you, Ella. Okay, we are over time, so we only have time for one quick question. I have one, but if anyone wants to take it. Okay. So I'm curious about the intravital imaging. Okay. Is this something that you're doing here in Tel Aviv? We have the instrument. How is
yes,
it done?
Yes, we have an instrument. It's called the CellVisio. It's like a small microscopic probe, like a small wire that you make a small cut in the mouse, insert the wire inside, and you can actually see on screen what's going on inside the mouse.
Okay. You can try me. Thank you very much.